Okay, so we begin with the transmission lines. So, transmission lines are used to transmit electrical energy from, or rather, electrical energy or signals, electrical signals from one point to another. And these two points are usually referred to as the source to destination or the generator to load. So source becomes, can also be called as the signal generator and the destination load. So generator to load. So this is how we identify what a transmission line is. Transmission lines are used to transmit electrical energy or signals from one point to another, that is source to destination or generator to load. Now, a schematic diagram can be easily, a simple schematic diagram can be drawn like this, which will make the idea clearer. The definition should already have made it clear what a transmission line is. So this is the source, and you have the destination or the load, and you have the transmission line which connects, the source to the load. Now, a few examples which as communication engineers, we would encounter situations where we would encounter a transmission line are. I'll just give a few examples where we are likely to encounter transmission lines from a communication engineering perspective. So you may need transmission lines to transfer data from one computer to another. You may need a transmission line to bring the signals from the cable TV provider to the TV sets. Or you may need a transmission line to connect the transmitter to the antenna in a wireless communication system, or vice versa. A transmission line is required to pass on the signals collected by the antenna to the receiver. And to add one more, you can have transmission lines in the form of connections between devices or units in a radio frequency circuit board. So these are some examples where we are likely to encounter a transmission line. So with this background, I could add that depending on the application, transmission line can be constructed or will be constructed in different forms, and two such forms in which you will come across a transmission line is the flat cable or the parallel wire transmission line. The other one which as communication engineers we come across often is the coaxial cable. So in the flat parallel wire or the flat cable, the construction is like this. You will have two parallel conducting wires. In practice, the transmission line can be very long. I am just drawing it here in the available space. So you'll have two parallel conducting wires, and there will be an insulating coating outside. So it looks somewhat like this. You will see a better picture of this shortly in this video itself. And this is how it looks like. And if I take a cross section of this, you will see the two wires like this. This is the cross section. And the radius of the wire we will say as A, we'll call it as A, radius A, and the distance from center to center is D. So if I show it here, this is D, and the radius of the wire is A. So this is a flat or parallel wire transmission line. And when it comes to the coaxial cable, you will have the construction is like this. You will have a cylindrical conductor at the center, surrounded by a cylindrical jacket, if I may say. Not a very thin one. Right. So in between, you will have either or rather in between you will have some dielectric. You'll have some dielectric. And there will be an outer jacket. So this is how a section of the coaxial cable will look like. You have an outer jacket. And the cross section would be, so this is a cylindrical conductor. You have a sort of cylindrical shell covering this conductor. You have dielectric in between, and these two can be used to close the circuit, and you can have the generator on one side, the load on the other. Similarly, you can have generator on one side here, and the load here. And the cross section of this, the cross section of the coaxial cable will look like this. Of course, it's obvious here as well. The cross section is obvious because I am showing it from such a perspective. This is how the cross section looks like. This is the cylindrical conductor, and this is the cylindrical shell. And dimension, the radius of this will be say A, this will be B, that is the distance from the center of this conductor to the inner region of the outer shell, and this will be C. So this is A, this is B, and this is C, and the cross section will be a circle, of course, and this region will have a dielectric insulator, that is a dielectric. So this, you will see immediately after this, you will see these videos. I will flash it in the video. You will see the pictures of these two types of constructions of transmission lines. Okay, now we move on to move on further with the discussion on transmission lines, and we discuss now something called as the lumped element, or the lumped parameter model of a transmission line. Now, so we discuss something called as the lumped element or the lumped parameter model of a transmission line. This is how we begin our analysis, the modeling of the transmission line. We model the transmission line first and then we analyze based on that model. So let's say that this is the source. So it's a sinusoidal source. From a communications perspective, this frequency can be very high. Anyhow, we'll discuss that later. Let us first develop the basic model. And you have the load somewhere here, the load impedance. And we call it as Z, Z for impedance, as you know, and a subscript R. The R says that it is at the receiving side. So the load impedance is at the receiving side. So ZR stands for the load impedance or the impedance of the receiver. So I will call this as the load. And you have the generator here, the signal generator. And we have the transmission line connecting the two. So I have shown it here like a block. This is the transmission line. You can think of it as a parallel wire or a flat cable for the time being, but you can easily visualize this being connected, the source and the load here being connected using a coaxial cable as well. And let us say that the length of the transmission line, that is the distance from the generator to the source, is L meters. I will use small l. So this is the distance and the transmission line is of length L. Now obviously this will have some resistance. The transmission line will have some resistance, and it will be a series resistance, and we write that resistance in the form of R ohm per meter. This is a series resistance. This is one of the parameters of the transmission line. R ohms per meter. So this transmission line as a whole will have a resistance of R into L, because L is the length. So R is ohms per meter. And since you are having these two wires in fairly close proximity, you will definitely have some inductance. And we call it, we represent it as L. Henry per meter. This is the inductance of the transmission line expressed per unit distance. So the total inductance of this transmission line will be capital L into small l, where small l is the length. And for example, if you take a section of this transmission line of length, say delta L, then the inductance will be L into delta L. And then you have two conductors separated by an insulator, so that will have some capacitance, can be very small, but still you will have some capacitance, which we will express as C, farad per meter, again expressed in terms of unit length. And this the dielectric or the insulator which separates these two conductors need not be perfect. There can be some leakage, and that manifests in the form of a shunt conductance, G Siemens per meter, again expressed per unit length. So these two parameters are actually coming together to form a shunt impedance. And these two will come together to form a series impedance. And these are the four transmission line parameters. There are a few more which I will discuss later. Now, let's say that we take a small, so I'll just create some space here. So I will just clean this figure. The idea is should be clear from this simple figure, which you can visualize easily. Now let's say this is our transmission line, fairly long. Let's say we take a small section of the transmission line. It's a small section, though I'm showing it here as a significant part of this. It's actually a very small section of a very long transmission line. Let the length of this small section be ds. Now if I, since the length is very small, I will treat this as a circuit. It will have a series resistance and an inductance. Recall that the line as a whole has a series resistance, a series inductance, a shunt conductance, and a shunt reactance or rather capacitance. And that shunt conductance and capacitance, shown like this, which means that I can model this tiny section of the transmission line as a small circuit. Since the resistance of the entire transmission line is R ohms per meter, this resistance, that is the resistance of this section, the series resistance of this small section, since the section length is ds, the resistance will be R ds. The resistance will be RDS and the inductance will be LDS, because the inductance is L Henry per meter for the transmission line as a whole. Since you are considering a section DS, the inductance will be LDS. Same argument, this will be CDS, because C is in farad per meter, the capacitance per unit length of the transmission line, and GDS, the conductance, which means that the total series impedance will be R plus J omega L. So we are assuming that it's a sinusoidal signal which is passing through this tiny section, R plus J omega L ds, the total series impedance, and the shunt reactance will be G plus J omega C ds. So this, with this tiny, in using this such similar small sections of the transmission line, we'll be able to analyze as a whole the transmission line and find out what is the voltage and current at any particular point on the transmission line. And through such analysis, we'll be able to understand more about the transmission line. So this is the background. Now, the question here is, why can't we use a model like this for the entire transmission line, so that the entire transmission line can be simplified to a small circuit like this, and then just calculate what is the input power and the output power. So why can't we treat the entire transmission line as a circuit like this? Instead of ds, I'll have the entire length, and then I will have the source here and the load here, and then why can't I simply analyze this? The reason why that is not possible can be explained as follows. Let's say the signal frequency from the, especially from the communications perspective, the frequency of the signal which is going to pass through this transmission line will be in the range of megahertz. So the frequency will be 10 power 6 hertz. It will be in the range of megahertz. And from the relation V, velocity is equal to frequency into lambda, and using the fact that the velocity, it's basically electromagnetic signal, so velocity is almost the velocity of light. So using this relation, we can find out what is the wavelength. I'll use the velocity of light itself here, it will be fairly close to this, divided by something of the order of 10 power 6, because frequency lambda is V by F, V I take as the velocity of light in free space. And the frequency is of the order of the megahertz, and this gives us a result which is something like 100 meters. So it will be around, that's what I mean, not exactly, around, because 10 power 8 by 10 power 6, we get a few hundreds of meters, or maybe somewhere around that, because this need not necessarily exactly be 3, it can be smaller than that. Anyhow, you are going to get it in the range of 100 meters or that, or somewhere around that. Now, let's say that the transmission line length is 1 kilometer. That is possible. 1 kilometer, that is 1000 meters. And the wavelength is 100 meters, which means that when the signal is propagating through this, if you take a snapshot, you will have something like 10 wavelengths fixed into this. This is not equal to 10, but I'm just showing the bifurcation. I think I have only shown here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So you'll have basically 10 wavelengths fitting into this 1 kilometer, right? So 100 into 10 gives me 1000 meters. So what happens is, you will have, again, schematically, if I show it for our sake of understanding, we will have something like this. So what you see is that this is a snapshot, and moreover the wave is propagating, the signal is propagating forward. So it is just, this is just, it's just going to be a moving wave from the source to the load. So what happens is, at any point in the, on the transmission line, the voltage is not going to be the same. It's going to fluctuate, it's going to change. And hence it is not possible to model the entire transmission line as a single resistance, inductance, a conductance, capacitance kind of circuit. Whereas when we take a tiny piece like this, you can see that when you take a small piece, a small section, that section is very, very small compared to the wavelength. And hence, when that happens, that small section can be treated as a simple circuit like this. And the entire transmission line can be treated as several such tiny sections, almost infinite number of them being put together to form the several kilometers long or the several meters long transmission line. So this is the reason why we have to go by an approach like this. So with this background, now we will use this model and develop what we call as the transmission line equations, and with the help of those equations, we'll be able to pursue further the discussions on transmission lines. Okay, so having understood the lumped parameter model, we will now discuss or derive the transmission line equation. We derive the transmission line equation, and I will just quickly draw the lumped parameter model here. So a tiny section of length ds of the transmission line is represented like this. RDS, LDS, GDS and CDS. We can represent it like this. And the series impedance here is as I said earlier, r plus j omega l ds, which we will just write as z ds. So z is r plus j omega l, and the shunt conductance is g plus j omega c ds, which we will write as y ds. So y is g plus j omega c. So with this, I can draw this with less number of components like this. So this becomes the z ds, and this is y ds. And of course the length is ds. Now let's say that, remember that the transmission line is made up of many sections like this. Let the input voltage to this tiny section be E plus dE. And let the drop across this series impedance be dE. That gives this as equal to E. And let the current entering this section from this side be I. And the current which is getting diverted through this shunt connection, let it be DI. So I DI, which means that the current which passes on to the next section is I minus DI. Right. So with this, now we can write certain very simple expressions. The drop here is DE. So I'll start writing from here. There is some space here. DE is equal to, using simple circuit laws, the drop across this is equal to I Z ds. Z ds is the impedance, I is the current, I to Z ds should give the drop dE, which gives dE by ds is equal to I Z. And the current, I'll write the expression here, DI, the current passing through this is equal to, again using simple circuit analysis knowledge that we have, EY DS, which means DI by DS is equal to EY. Now differentiating these two again, I write d square E by d s square is equal to z di by ds. Z di by ds, I'll skip that step. Z di by, because I am differentiating this d square E ds square is equal to z di by ds. Di by ds is here, which means that I write it like this, which I will write as gamma square E. So d square E by ds square is equal to gamma square E. We have got a differential equation for E now, which means that I can write E as a function of S, and S is the distance along the transmission line, where of course gamma is square root of zy. Similarly, we can write d square I by d s square equal to, using similar argument, if I differentiate this again with respect to s, I will get y dE by dS, which will give me z y I. I get similar expression for current as well. Of course, gamma I have already told what is gamma. Gamma is square root of z y. So now, if I solve these equations, which is they are very simple solutions. Solutions are very simple. You know how to solve this. So I'll write the solution here. If I solve this, I'll create some space here to write the solutions. If I solve this, I get E as equal to a constant into e power gamma s plus a constant b into e power minus gamma s. That is the solution for E. And likewise, since these are identical equations, I will be having a solution c a constant e power gamma s plus d e power minus gamma s. So we have the solutions, and now the task is to find out these constants. So what we do is I differentiate, let's call this as equation 1, in case we have to refer to this again. So I differentiate equation 1 again, dE by dS. I differentiate equation 1, I write, I find out what is dE by dS. dE by dS is A gamma e power gamma S minus B gamma e power minus gamma s. We are just differentiating this. And from here, we know that dE by dS is equal to I into z. So we know that dE by dS is equal to I into z. So this becomes I into z. That is, from this relation, we see that I is equal to square root of y by z gamma, or rather A gamma is absorbed here. I will explain how. E power gamma s minus root y by z b e power minus gamma s. So what we have done here is we just take this z over here to get I as equal to a gamma by z e power gamma s minus b gamma by z e power minus gamma s. Now gamma is here as root z y. Gamma is given here as root z y. We have called gamma as root z y. So root z y, if you divide by z, you will get root y by z. That is how the gamma by z we have written as root y by z. So this expression we have here for the current. And we have an expression here for E. So using equation 1 and this, we solve for A and B. And through a similar jugglery, we will solve for C and D. So how exactly we do that? Now, we have the source here for the transmission line. And the load here. ZR, the load here, and the load is situated at, so this is the S, so the so-called S direction or the S axis, if we may call so, because we are taking the section of transmission line as DS. So the load is at S equal to 0, and the generator is at S equal to L, which means that the total length is L as it was earlier. So now in equation 1, in equation 1 over here, if I substitute S as equal to 0, I should get the voltage here, because S0 takes me exactly at the load. So if I substitute S0 here, I should get ER, that is the potential drop across the load, because S0 is exactly on the load, and this is the way the potential behaves on the line. So when S is equal to 0, I should have the potential across the load. So ER is equal to A plus B, because S is set to 0. Similarly, if I substitute S as 0 here, I should get the current through the load, because S0, as I said, is the point, is the location where I have the load. So IR is equal to, that is the current through the load, is equal to root Y by ZA minus root Y by ZB. So I have equations like this. I get two equations like this from which I can easily solve for A and B. So before I do that, I would like to introduce a new parameter here of the transmission line. This is the right time for that. We will call root Z by Y as equal to Z naught, which is called as the characteristic impedance of the line. Characteristic impedance. Characteristic impedance of the transmission line. It is a parameter of the transmission line, and you can see that dimensionally this is an impedance, because Z is an impedance and Y is actually an inverse impedance. So that means this becomes square root of impedance square, which gives us an impedance. So with this notation or this introduction of the new parameter, we can write this as equal to A by Z naught, B by Z naught. So A by Z naught minus B by Z naught. So now we have ER. If we solve this from these two relations, of course, before I do that, I can write ER as equal to, since ER is the drop here, ER is the drop here, and IR is the current through this. ER by IR has to be ZR. Simple Ohm's law. ER by IR has to be ZR. So I had ER here earlier. So I will replace it by IR ZR, and the ZR I will take here. So now eliminate A and B from this, we will try to do that. IR ZR equal to A plus B, and IR Z naught is equal to A minus B. So that gives A as equal to, A will be equal to IR ZR plus IR Z naught by 2. And similarly, B will be, so when I calculate B, I subtract this from this. So I will get IR ZR minus IR Z naught by. So I subtract this from this, and I get IRZR minus IRZ0 by 2. And of course, to bring it to the textbook form, IRZR, we can write IRZR is nothing but ER. And of course, IRZR is ER here as well. So we have solved for A and B. A is ER plus IRZ0 by 2. And B is ER minus IRZ0 by 2. And using similar method, using a similar method, that is by differentiating this with respect to S and then going through similar steps, one can show that C is equal to ER by Z naught plus IR by 2 and D is equal to IR minus ER by Z naught by 2. One can show that C and D are like this. And of course, after some manipulation with all these four constants, you can further manipulate them. Very simple manipulations, and write A as equal to ER by 2. Just take ER by 2 common, and you'll have 1 plus Z naught by ZR. B will be ER by 2, 1 minus Z naught by ZR. C will be IR by 2, 1 plus ZR by Z naught, and D will be IR by 2, 1 minus ZR by Z naught. So we have, in a way, the complete solution now. We have all the four constants with us, and we also know how the nature of the variation of the potential as well as the current with respect to the length along the transmission line. So putting all these together, we can now write our complete solution like this. We can write our complete solution like this, which is nothing but E is equal to ER into ZR plus Z naught divided by 2 ZR e raised to gamma s plus z r minus z naught divided by z r plus z naught e power minus gamma s. This is the expression for the potential as a function of the distance along the transmission line. And I is equal to IR ZR plus Z naught by 2 Z naught e raised to gamma S plus Z naught minus ZR divided by Z naught plus ZR e raised to minus gamma S. And we can further manipulate this. In fact, I have skipped a couple of steps here, which I felt is very elementary. So the ABCD we found out earlier, you just put it in the solution and just manipulate it. You'll get it in this form, simple manipulations. And further, if we could multiply this with the ZR plus Z naught, and take, that is, in other words, take ZR plus Z naught as a common factor, it get cancelled. Similarly, Z naught plus ZR, you take a common factor, it gets cancelled. In the process, this will get multiplied by this, this will get multiplied by this. And then you can group ZR terms and Z naught terms and write this in another form, which again, simple manipulation, so I leave it to you, you can do it. E can be expressed as ER hyperbolic cos gamma s plus IR z naught hyperbolic sine gamma s. Similarly, I can be shown to be IR hyperbolic cos gamma s plus ER by Z naught hyperbolic sine gamma s. So this completes our solution. So we now know what will be the electric field, I'm sorry, what will be the voltage and the current across the transmission line. So if you put substitute, as we did earlier, if you put substitute, obviously S is equal to zero, you would get the potential across the load and the current through the load. And for other values of S, you will know what is the potential and the potential and the current along the transmission line. So with this, we will discuss the, or we will analyze further the transmission line. We will learn more about the transmission line with this equation.